Okay, this one on her wrist that we're talking about, oh, this one here. It's a circle, and just so everybody knows, I mean, Sarah's never told anybody this publicly, I'm just going to say it for her. This is actually exactly the shape of my face, and which you didn't want people to know, so we didn't put any hair or ears on it. We designed it together, though, and I had one as well, but it's on my lower back. Or a tramp stamp, if you will. I don't think Sarah has any meanings for her tattoos. She won't even tell me.
I do. I have a very like weird thing about tattoos. Like I never tell people I'm getting them, and I never tell people what I'm getting before I get them. And I'm not like a t-shirty person. I have a lot of tattoos on my arms. I just always like, every time I see myself in a t-shirt, I'm like, it's weird. It's weird. It's so it's nothing personal. It's nothing personal. That I feel it's too personal to just tell you. I don't know why it's weird. It's like, it's not that big of a deal, but
you have to keep some things for yourself.
You do have to keep some things for yourself, and or at least pretend like you're keeping some stuff for yourself. But the thing about tattoos that's really interesting is that I also just wish I had never gotten any of them.
One person's like you.
Maybe that's part of why I don't like to talk about them, is that I'm just like, what? Don't bring them up, all right? Just get off my back about it, you know? But
this next song Sarah wrote for me.
Come on.
Yep. She sent it to me. She's in demo form. And she said, no. She, thank you. And she,
you did it, though.
She did. She sent it to me, and she said that she was feeling really inspired by me, and that she really wanted to write a song, and that she'd always been so busy writing songs for girls, and that she just never thought to write it for the one girl in her life that's most special to her, her sister. So it's a little angry for me. I was hoping for something maybe sweeter, like back in her head vein, but okay. But I was like, come on, I'll take it. I ended up not being the most popular song on the record, which disappointed me a bit, because then I would have got to tell this story more often. But I want you guys to
put me in this awkward position where you make it seem like I don't respect you and care about you, but the truth is that you pick awkward songs to say. This is like a new shtick of Tegan's, where she introduces to a huge group of people the next song, and it's written for her, and then it's like usually something. Okay, for example, there's a song coming up in the set list called Bodywork, which is a song that I did with a dance artist.
That's another song Sarah wrote
for
me.
No, it's a sexy song. Song about sexy things,
which weirded me out at first.
Sorry, guys. Listen. Okay, you don't even look that embarrassed, which indicates to me that Mom hasn't explained this to anything yet. I'm just gonna say to the rest of you,
I'm so lost.
But anyway, yeah, you know what I'm saying. And Tegan the other night introduced in front of probably 7,000 people Bodywork as being a song written about her. And the whole song, I was just like, no. It was weird at first because the lyrics are like, you do your body work, I feel your body working over time. And I was like, that's a weird thing to say to your sister. But then I was like, it's not for her. None of them are. So that's cool. She doesn't want to tell you. So she's not ready yet. Hop back in the sister closet. This song actually, I only do it because the truth is, because Sarah never tells anyone what her songs are about. I'm like, so, how's everyone doing? This next song, let me just draw a picture for you. Oh, I have photos, hold on. And people are like just are obsessed with Sarah. Like, it's been going on for about a year now. Like, she's just giving less and less, and they just come and they're like, Sarah, please, tell me what anything about you. And she's just like, no. Like, that's personal. I would just make up a story about them because I hate to let people down. They're like, where do you get your haircut? She's like, none of your business. And so this is a lesson to Sarah. Open up, be brave, let them in. Trust. This one's for me.
But like, I don't think we should play anymore. I know I've trained her for 2 days in a row. I think it needs a rest. It needs to go on the bench and sit out a show. And Sarah's like, no, you have to play it. And so now I, not purposely.
Have you taught me a lesson?
I fucked it up. No, I'm not trying to teach you a lesson, so here we go. I'm going to play the rest of this song, and I want every single person in this place to turn around and look at the girl who's giving us a finger, because apparently all of our hard work and energy is not worth her giving us respect. So I'm going to turn around and give her the finger, and I'll finish the fucking song.
Fuck you.
Okay. Fuck off. Hold on. The point has been made. What is my maid?
Seriously,
you don't need to say hey.
No, seriously.
Why don't you, what are you going like this for? Like, fuck off.
Get
hey,
fuck off and get out of
you're the adult. Everyone's going to take a little bit of a breather here. We're all going to, Sarah turned this into a football match. It's not a football match. We're all going to smile. Let's all take a deep breath together. Watch the girl say no. That's going to give them a lot easier. We just did what I thought, which was everyone turn around and make the girl feel bad, and then we can all start it up again. Here's the thing. This is past the line of starting again, I think. I think that you should sing the third verse, because I think it's such a pretty verse. I think you should sing it by yourself.
I wake up to the sound of you working one room right over.
You sing about wanting to put your heart in somebody's chest.
No, no, that's later on in the song. I don't, that's like in the bridge part.
Yeah, that's true.
See, you don't even know the song. You should fucking blame me.
There's another verse. Anyone here?
No, you don't know it all. You've
been at 100 shows and you're like, I don't know, is there another verse? I'll just sing the rest of the song. We'll skip all the words.
The shame is I love you.
It likes what you're doing, but then you do it for too long. And you do it too hard, and then I'm all like, get away! And I will stand out there for hours. I will sign every CD, I will do it all, but the second that you're like, oh, you're tired? Well, this is part of your job.
Then I'm like, we're a good balance, though, because I'm like one of the cats that like a little kid could play with or put clothes on, and I'd be like, and then they'd be like, let's have to take pictures of the cat in the shirt, and I'd be like, okay.
No, I'm here to protect you so that you don't get put in cat shows, which is totally wrong. Anyway, it was kind of, I felt a little bit bad afterwards, but then I didn't. When I walked on the bus,
then
all
you
the band members, they were all like,
yeah, yeah!
And I was all like,
yeah!
You went to me! Okay, so. Too far.
This one's for that girl who's probably never like, going to be the same after last night.
Whatever, she probably went online last night like, Tina, that's a bit.
And I'm going to be all like, Sarah looks good when she's dressed up in a little outfit with a bow tie.
Just stare at me and smile. Put your arm around the person next to you. Give them a little squeeze. Like that. These people are doing it. I can't actually tell if you're doing it. Oh, some of you are doing it. Okay. A lot about mortality and what it's going to be like. What do you want to do tomorrow? You just want to like walk around and go to the flea market? Or I think we should make wills. I got tombstones. I thought we could just chisel up together. Too far. I've been working on your tombstone. I decided that we should use aerial. Before we go to bed, I'd like to talk to our worry dolls. I'm worried about you. I'm worried about me. I talk to my worry dolls every night. You don't? Mom gave them to us for Christmas. Okay. What does love mean to me? Oh boy. I mean, let me tell you a little bit of a quick story here about my blankie that I was wearing at Walmart.
Blankie?
Everyone has one. Everyone has like a blankie or like a rag that your mom puts on you to shut you up. Or whatever. They're just like, you're crying and they're like, yeah, it's just a blankie. Just cuddle it or hump it or rub it or whatever you do. Who didn't have one? Our parents give it to us when we're in a... create a bond with it while we're in an incubator. They don't give it to you at, like, you're four and you're crying. They're like, here's a blankie. Bond with it. Like, just saying that everyone has a blankie and you... Everyone has. I still have one. It's still, my blankie is at home in Montreal. It's in this red.
You have a blankie still?
Of course I still have.
Where's mine?
Mom, where's mine?
I don't have it.
It's probably with the
yellow.
Every
time my mom can't find something, she's like, I gave it to you.
Anyways. Oh, sorry. I'm getting.
Ah, I'm so upset! Blankie?
Okay, so my blankie was called Blankie or B. For short. And as I got older, it became embarrassing, and you have to put Blanky away. You have to put him in a... He was...
Him?
Yeah. I sort of had a heterosexual relationship. It wasn't sexual. I mean, it was a kid, so it was like... Anyways. So Blanky and I sort of...
Poor parent is holding their child in her arms. Can you just hurry it up?
Okay, so... That child probably has a blankie. All I can say about love is this.
Oh, my God.
Blanky and I... We're so close, and I was close to Tegan, and obviously I love my parents and my friends and all of these things. But Blankie and I were super close, and I put Blankie in this red container thing, and I put it up in the closet. And a few weeks ago, I was telling some friends about when Tegan and I were little. Tegan fucked up something with my grandma. My mom was pissed at Tegan about my grandma. Tegan had done something bad to my grandma.
What?
I don't know. I can't remember the exact story. Mom, don't shake your head. You know where I'm going with this. Hold on. And my mom and dad sat down with us at the dinner table, and they told Tegan that they were going to take Blankie away from her Blankie away from her as punishment. And she started flipping out, and she was like, no, you can't take Blankie away from me. And then she was losing her mind. And apparently... Maybe it was the other reverse. Like, it could have been me crying and Tegan, but whatever. One of us interjected and said, like, we were like four. And one of us said, like, too far. You can't take Blankie away. Mom, did that. Roughly, that's the story, right? She's laughing, she's crying, she's sobbing. She can't believe the story is so visceral for her. She remembers it clearly. But the truth is this, like, I, at 4 years old, I didn't just know
it was definitely you, because if it was me, I would have gone, got scissors, cut my Blankie in half, and given half to you.
Aww. Here's the thing. This is my vague way of answering your question. Not only did I love my Blankie, but I understood love so deeply that I understood Tegan's love of Blankie. And I couldn't bear the thought that she would be torn apart from this thing. You know, like, I was just like, at 4 years old, I could like logically step outside of my...
We literally got out of bed at like a port slash... dump. And it was like garbage and like more garbage, and like there must have been like something awful buried in the garbage because it was worse than garbage. And I could not stop laughing, and the next day I got a week of vicious diarrhea and throw up. And I think it's because our minds are like taking in, yeah, like totally, it was like a combination of like trauma and like just way too much feces to come out. That doesn't make sense. That's what I thought later on. You're not making sense. We didn't want to cover this very much in the movie, but Tegan and I did get Deli Belly and I lost 5 pounds. No, it is a great place to go. You should still visit. I mean, if you get diarrhea or whatever, it's like I lost 5 pounds, I'm right for this. It's not like a win-win situation. It's too bad we didn't shoot the documentary in Australia and New Zealand, because it was just, we were really out of time. But truthfully, the Deli Belly, there was this. No. I was teasing you because you said that we got Deli Belly from that.
No, it was not a dump. I mean, there was like part of the poop in there for sure.
I don't think that's okay with Deli Belly, but other things,
it's not
Deli Belly. You guys are laughing. I'm not laughing. I'm very serious. Tegan's making Deli Belly seem fun because she's being all cute and funny, but that shit was real. I thought we were going to die. I thought there was a moment in the hotel room where I realized that I was like, it was seriously like, I was in the hotel and I was like, you know, maybe I want to watch a DVD and stay in tonight, even though we didn't have so much in India. Tegan had said that she was going to skip dinner as well. So we're just like hanging out in my room. And then a hawk, I have a video of it, it's very weird, a hawk lands on the windowsill.
Ellie, confirm that you've seen this video and it's true.
I don't know if you showed me the video.
You saw the video. Okay, I need like a real person to do. This is a true story. I'm in a hotel room in
I don't know if it's a hawk, but it's a bird.
Oh, it's a hawk. It is a hawk. They were flying. It has wings. I'm going to post it online. In the next few days, I will post this video online. But you can see, I'm filming in the hotel room, and a hawk lands on the windowsill. And I walk over, and I move the curtain aside to see the hawk, and the hawk flies away. But you can see it's sitting on the windowsill where the curtain. And I kid you not, 15 minutes later, I was like, I'm going to go into the bathroom. I definitely feel something. And then 20 minutes later, I was dripping wet, soaked to the bone. Emptied. My soul and everything inside of my body. And I went to the phone and I called Ellie. And I couldn't, the voice that came out was a stranger to me. I was like, Ellie, can't you see you? Ellie, did I ask you this? Like, I wasn't even worried about me. I was like, I'm very ill. Bullshit, because we both had the same instinct. I thought I was going to watch Treatment all night, and Tegan was going to shit her brains out, but we got sick. So sick, and I was like, Ellie, get to Tegan. I think she's sick. And Ellie came up to me, and I was like on the back of the floor, and she was like, get up, that's trashy.
Where the fuck
are you? She had a vision. It was a vision. You are about to get very ill.
Was it the horse therapist that said to you?
Yeah. The horse therapist was like, Sarah, I come to you in the form of a hawk. You're about to get very, very ill, but then that bread is not something you should eat when you're ill. You should, according to the Indian doctor, you should eat rice, you idiot. No, it was a really harrowing experience. And my mother, again, none of this is in the film because found the energy to rip the camera out of Ellie's hands and she pointed it at me. But my mother came home from shopping and I was in bed and I was like, you think I was on my deathbed? I was like, mom. And she was like, she just opened my hand and went, 100 pills. And she goes, she's a teacher and a therapist and she had gone on this boat trip through the Amazon a couple years ago and all the kids got sick on it. And she says to me, as she's putting the pills in, she goes, you're fine. I was on a boat trip in the Amazon. Kids were having seizures. You're not going to die. And I was like, oh my God. So she's super therapeutic.
You know, I know it's a common thing to use this this phrase, but in our band we talk a lot about crossing the line, i.e. that you like said, for example, like when I said the thing about having bum sex in a jacuzzi, like that would have been, somebody would have said, okay, you've crossed the line. And I just want to say, because I know that there might be younger people here, that if you've had bum sex in a jacuzzi, I wasn't making fun of you. I'm not judging anybody. Like, I think that there's a lot of sexual there's a lot of sexual shame in America. You don't see a lot of sexual images because, like, you turn on MTV and it's like everyone is like covered from head to toe clothing. It's just we've become an uncomfortable society with our own bodies. And if I can start a movement for more people to just feel comfortable, if you just want to, like, say for example you wanted to like lather yourself up in soap and rub yourself along the front of a car in a video, that would not be, there is nothing wrong with that at all. Like Tegan, for example, one time, like not even for a music video, like I went over to Tegan's house the other day and she was washing her car and then we just took all of our clothes off and we rolled around in the bed. One, I don't own a car, I don't even have a driver's license. Two, we don't live in the same city. Three, just the idea that you had that thought in your head makes me feel sad inside. It's deep, deep, deep sadness that will motivate me to sing all the sad songs that I've ever written. Yeah. Okay. I'm only kidding.
And if you say the thing that you've already said a couple times across the line again,
yeah,
you won't have a backing band. Yeah. You're going to have to keep all these people entertained. Just play Walking with a Ghost a couple hundred times.
So he's so upset about that whole soap thing. Anyways, I'm obviously joking, you big sluts in America.
But we love you!
Dirty bunch of slut generation. Anyways, okay, so this is another song.
Now I feel obstructed. Okay, I can't move around or else it's gonna just fly open. Next song, have the tape ready. My shirt can
fly.
There'd be nothing for any of you to look forward to.
You know what's so weird is that we play music, but I also love going to see bands play, and I like watching music, and the last thing I've ever thought, like I've never once sat in the audience and thought, oh damn, I hope she takes her shirt off. I really hope that he plays it in his boxers. I really have a hard time believing. I think that you're confused, and what you want is to go to the strippers. And it would be so much easier for you to get what you paid for if you were there. What did you just say?
I can't say it.
Now you can't say it. But anyways, it's cute that you want to see Tegan nude, but sadly, I think that's against the Vancouver Olympic Committee's rules. I'm not concerned. Don't smoke pot. Don't smoke pot either. You can't smoke pot any. But I bet if you wanted to be in a one-piece unitard, like a Louis Vuitton, yeah. I couldn't be an athlete. There's too many rules. Too many rules.
You're 12. Not as cute as you are. I mean, we were kind of weird. We had long banger hair and
12. 12 was grade 7. And that was
12?
Yeah. 11 turning 12. We were in grade 7. Yep. Grade 3, we were 8. These people are like, no. Like, they were there. They're like, actually, Sarah, no, we were 3. We were 8 in grade 3. 9 in grade 4. 10. You keep working forward, and I'll get to the story. But we were in grade 7, trust me. And what happened in the summer between grade 6 and grade 7 is that we went through puberty. And at the same time as we were going through puberty, we were also in Florida with our family on vacation.
Hey, we weren't going through puberty in Florida.
Okay, I was.
It lasts longer than 2 weeks.
I was going through puberty. Listen, maybe you weren't. I had a really hard time because we were from Calgary. We didn't do a lot of swimming outside of like going to like the water slide pool or whatever. And you go like once, and if you were from Northeast Calgary, you wore jean shorts, it didn't matter, so. But, the Northeast Calgary
people are like,
oh my god, are you kidding me? That was acceptable bathing suits, with jean shorts and a really extra large t-shirt, but anyway. My best friend Robin, who grew up in the Northeast, is hysterically sobbing right now because she knows it's true. But so we went to Florida, and it was our family vacation, and we were wearing jean shorts and an oversized t-shirt. It was not cool. It was bathing suit territory, and I remember being incredibly uncomfortable, and I also, because I was going through puberty, Tegan was just going through months and years of puberty, but I just had it immediately, because what happened was that I went from being a kid to going, holy shit, those girls in bathing suits make me feel uncomfortable. Like, I'd like
what
to be...
What was the question again? I can't remember.
Shh. Oh, what were we like when we were 12? Okay. Listen. Come on, just back off my story here. Anyways, the point is that I started to really develop into the teenager I was about to become. And this feels like an installation, like you're trying to distract. 12 sucked, because 12 through 15... were awkward years based on my gender and sexuality and everything. It was a very complicated time, and I also struggled because I was in a school where kids were really tough, and it was a really intense environment, and we were sensitive inside, and we had to act tough, and, you know, like, fight and push people, and just...
We were wearing Mickey Mouse sweaters, everybody else was giving blowjobs.
Yeah, I was sorry. But so we
wasn't
pulled it together.
We were pulled it together.
And I wasn't like, oh, I feel really insecure, I wish that I could do that. I was like, guys, we're 12. What?
So it was I hope you're not doing that.
Be 12, don't. Just stay 12. You're going to feel compelled to change, but don't. Just when I was 12, my favorite game with Tegan and our best friend Heather was Raft. And basically Raft was a role-playing game. It's a role-playing game where you did... It's sort of not unlike charades, but you did it all in a blow-up raft in Heather's living room, and... It was sort of like a magic carpet. Anyways, about halfway through...
I can't understand what you're saying. I'm standing next to you. I just feel very loud. I can't even hear. We need a monitor. I can't even hear what's happening.
About halfway through grade 7, we stopped playing Raft, and... okay, next question.
Me as a kind of girl that, like, if I went home with someone and they were like, this is my room, and they turn the light on and there's, like, stuffed animals and, like, their childhood blanket on the bed, I would be like... I really want to get into bed with you. You know, like, I'm just saying, like, I want to feel like a person who's confident, you know? Like, but having said that, this song that I'm about to play, what I was just thinking about, what I could say about it, and I wrote it when I was living on my own for the first time in Montreal, and I just started dating someone, and when they came over the first time to see my bedroom, I didn't have stuffed animals, but I had, I have a installed my own bolt lock on my bedroom door. I don't know, I was nervous. I was living on my own for the first time, so, like, the first time I was like, this is my bedroom, and then I, like, closed the door, and I was like, I can't do that. And I'm like, no, like, to keep people out, not to keep you in.
Maybe,
something
like that in here.
Maybe it just sounds like that in here.
Maybe.
I only used in-ears a few times. I put them on every single night though because we have a different sound man now. We have a connection and he understood. He made me get them made, and then the first day I was like, I'm not using those, and he was just like, okay, whatever. But it's your money, basically, is the look he gave me. But our old sound guy, he's awesome. I love him, and he's out with a different band now. But his name was Craig, and every day for 2 years he would put my in-ears backstage and I would put them on. And, you know, plug my pack in, and I would come out. And I think part of the reason why I wanted the in-ears is because it feels cool. Because all the other musicians are doing it. And so I was like, everybody else has in-ears, we should get in-ears. And, like, they look cool. I look at Sarah and Ted, and, like, they got the wires sticking out, and I'm like, cool. It's like having an iPod in your ear, you know? But I hate them, and for 2 years, Craig tried to get me to use them, and every day I would dramatically come out on stage with them and be like, I got in-ears, yeah. And then we always start the set with I Bet It's Dumb. And so we come in with I Bet It's Dumb, and we're like, ah, this sounds like shit. It sounds so horrible. It's like having a, you know, like, in-ears. I mean, and like earbuds, you know? It's like there's no rock, you know? There's no bottom. And so I would dramatically pull them out from behind my shirt and just dump them on stage. And I could see Craig, no matter how big the venue, and he'd be like, his little heart would turn into a sad face, and I'd just be like, so the next day, he'd be like, do you gonna put your ears on your... And I'd be like, okay, and I'd sound check up with him and be like, ugh. And then I'd come out, throw them on the ground. But one of the first shows that I used in ears in, I spent most of the night being like, what? And pulling it out, I had long hair over my ear, and I'd like, untuck it and pull the in-ear out, and I'd be like, what did you say? And they're like, you suck. And I'm like, okay. My hair, little pocket mirror. And then I'd hear something else, and I'd be like, what? And pull it out, and I'm like, sorry, I can't hear you, what? And they'd be like, yeah! And I'd be like, oh, put it back in. And it's very discombobulating, so, anyway.
That's why I got these haircuts, all the in-ear haircuts.
Yeah.
Like, there's no hair, so you can just follow me and pop
them
out.
With genius. No one near gets it, but I get it.
Anyways, I'm glad that you used up the in-between time to talk about that one.
Yeah, totally. Well, now you can start the song.
Yeah, that's more common.
Let's see, last night you told an 8-minute story about your fucking birthday, and you're like, so I think it's going to be okay. Come on. If I didn't have such a strong, robust ego, I might take it mentally that Tegan doesn't like it always when they tell stories. But I love your stories. It's just, it's called sharing. And sometimes you
doesn't provide any comfort or food or anything like that.
No, you already got wrong.
The point is that it's basically just two monkeys and it's a study on like maternal stuff and like will they go to the monkey that gives them love or the food and they'll go to the monkey that gives them love, not food or whatever. Anyway, Sarah's trying to explain it. This is in response to a question about if we find purpose in what we do. It made no sense. And at the end, I just said, I was like, I don't know, like, I got scared. Man. I got sweaty.
At College Station, they were probably all smoking bombs.
It doesn't matter, you weren't. And I was like, what the hell is happening? And so I, like, calmly was like, Sarah, I'm not really sure what you're saying. And then Sarah was like, she just like, it was like, we find purpose in what we do. And then she was like, you know, when we write a song, it doesn't matter. Like, was contradicting herself. After she would say one thing, she would say another thing. And the guy looked so confused, and he was like, I totally understand what you mean. And I was like, but I knew he didn't. And I was like, what's happening? Everybody's freaking me out. And I was like, I knew that she was high. And I was like, you're acting high, fever, whatever. But I was like, I think you're on cold medication, you're acting high. And then Sarah was like, I'm not. And then started to argue with me live on radio. And I was like,
Tegan was so calm. She wasn't. She was looking at me like a gigantic, like a spider had crawled over my face or something. And she had this look of terror on her face. And I was like, relax, college radio. I don't know. All I know is I brought it up a couple days later. And Sarah was like, yeah, I don't know what I was talking about. That's great. Okay. It's a really interesting episode on This American Life. Anyways, if you don't know This American Life, on NPR, it's amazing. It's an interesting documentary from the 50s, and they were just talking about it, and it was interesting about monkeys. I was just reading on, I swear to God, I just read that chimpanzees in Japan are beating college students in games, like in computer games, mind memory games and stuff like that.
Wow.
Chimpanzees, Yep, they're beating college students in games. They seem really complicated. They're the exact kind of games that a chimpanzee could beat a human in. It's like, they show you like 9 numbers in random order, and then you have to like, they show it to you for like half a second or something, and then you have to like, try to remember where. That seems so hard.
What kind of skills? Our minds are full of a lot of other things. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't know. So what are you saying now? It's like you're justifying. You're saying that the chimpanzees have nothing to think about.
Chimpanzees don't have to pay taxes or.
You're talking about capitalist responsibility. You think the chimpanzees are free?
I think that we have to process our feeling and we have to do taxes and we have a lot of other things to do. So you put me in jail for like 5 years, and then you start showing me numbers. I probably would never do it. Chimpanzee's just glad that it's not being tested, like, you know, food products or new chemical aren't being tested on this.
Not chicken.
Like, I can remember the numbers, keep me around forever. I'm really smart. Don't put makeup on me.
That's what this one's about. Went to the dentist and I had to have all my wisdom teeth removed and I didn't have a lot of money and I didn't want to ask my parents for money, so I decided to get my wisdom teeth out without, you know, when they put you under or whatever. So I just did it with like, where they just give you like local anesthetic so that it numbs it out. And I don't even know if I was brave. Everyone just was like, the dentist was super chill with me about it. Like, he was like, you're not going to feel anything. It's just, it's more pleasant if you go under. But it was like, it was the difference between like $800 and I remember like $2,400. Yeah. And I was like, I can afford $800. So I got my wisdom teeth pulled out. And it was deeply, deeply traumatizing. And I spent months coping with.
Sarah called me like, I was getting mine done a week later. And she called me like, she was like, get put under. Ask mine for money, don't do it. I fully intended on doing it. I was like, hell yeah.
It was horrifying on so many levels.
What's the record you can't listen to?
I can't listen to U2 Acton Baby because the dentist told me I could bring a
I could bring a Discman. This was in 2000. And it's so violent because my teeth were impacted, so they had to like crack them and pull them off. And like, it was so violent that the headphones fell off my head, but I could still hear the album, but I was like... They were like putting the bloody tools like on my wrist.
Oh my god.
Like flopping them down while they're doing that. Like I was just like, wake up. My experience is totally different. They just put me under, I woke up. I was apparently flirting with the dentist, I don't remember, the doctor. And then I flew home, I'm a baby, I flew home and stayed at my mom's house and I enjoyed it quite.
It's like I was in the third world country.
Yeah.
It was
so traumatizing. I was like, I was so stressed out and so tense that I bruised all the way down to my belly button. I looked like I had been run over by a car. It was, I mean, I can't even tell you, like, the, I was...
What does that have to do with the video?
I'm gonna get to that. About a week after it happened,
oh, yeah.
I was in bed, and at the time I was still dating Emmy, who's our art director and still continues to work with us. But at the time we were still in a relationship and I woke up and the swelling had gone down enough that I wasn't wearing this bandana over my face anymore because I was ashamed. And I looked at her and I said, I'm not going to ever be the same. I don't feel like I'm the same person. I went through, you just can't know how troubling that 7.5 minutes was. And it was so insane. And the whole time that I was having my teeth removed, it was one of these dentist offices where it was just partial walls, so I could hear Emmy talking on the cell phone to my mom. And she was like, she's fine, she just went in, she'll just be out in a second. And it's like, you two act like baby on the floor, and the tools, and the teeth, and I just was like, it was insane. Anyways, Emmy was like, we were always collaborating and doing art and whatever, and she was like, I think that to get through it, you should like do an art project or something, or talk about like what you went through or whatever, like, and I seriously wrote a video treatment, but I mean, I was on painkillers, I was suffered emotional trauma unlike anything I'd ever felt before, and then I wrote that treatment, and then I approached a friend that was really bizarre and does comic books and really strange things and whatever, and he sort of took my ideas, and it's just, I mean, the video is supposed to be, I guess, about, you know, I guess, like, the hospital gurney scene and all that stuff. I mean, it's sort of like the disorientation of dental surgery when you're too poor to pay to go on. Kind of the underlying concept.
A lot of drugs.
We couldn't watch the movies because we were just actually, we don't like to pick groupies from our own crowd, so we just hit all the other bars and clubs in the city. And we just pick up groupies at other shows.
You know what's horrifying is that as we get further and further into our career, this has happened more than once. I've met people who have sworn that their friends have hooked up with us, and like one guy who was selling me a pair of jeans about a year ago in Toronto told me that his best friend lived with me for a year. Like, what's your best friend's name? Because I've only lived with one person. Like, it was a friend, it wasn't a romantic thing. They're like, yeah, Jeff! You know Jeff, Jeff! And I'm like, standing, I was like, are you fucking... Your friend is a liar. The guy, I swear to God, got tears in his eyes, got so flustered, he was like, my friend swore that he lived with me. Who the fuck is your friend? It was such a weird moment, I didn't swear at all, I was like, really horrified. I was like, something crazy's happening. So we don't pick people up, we're very shy and awkward. We are, like tonight specifically, surrounded by like people we've known most of our lives. We're really weird. The concept of groupie is fascinating to me and awesome, and there certainly are people that travel around and see a lot of Tegan and Sarah shows, and we know them by name and love them and think that they're absolutely wonderful. I would never ever bring them back to my house and sleep with them, that would be fine. Or I guess that's, look, you can tell if you don't know what groupies, I guess you don't bring them back to us, you just bring them back safe.
Okay, I would never put a full wall of glass from my bed to the bathroom. Like, I would never be like, you know what my apartment needs? A wall of glass. With a mirror. I mean a mirror. This is, I'm sorry, that was totally confusing. What I mean is a mirror. And with a reflection. I don't know what you all were laughing at before I said mirror, because
we understood. We weren't going to
correct you.
Very good. Okay.
A reflective surface that reflects back my image I would never want one of those on purpose.
You know what would be genius is would be like a video screen between your bed and your bathroom, and it's triggered by your movement, and then like super like tall and skinny and like in a cute outfit, like you're wearing like just a white wife beater and like a pair of underwear, and you're just like walking along beside yourself, and you're like,
no, you
me.
It's gotta be the opposite of your pajama look. So you're like, if you're in some sort of pajama or whatever you're wearing.
Well, I don't wear a white wife beater and a pair of underwear to bed, so.
Well, you basically just.
I'd be walking around with my full pajamas, and I would be like, ooh, I'm cute.
I would want me in like a runway situation wearing something I would never wear. Like I'm wearing like some sort of like super couture, like, you know, and it's like there's like a drum beat and it's a runway and there's like photographers and all this music. And I was like walking in the back. Good morning. But instead what I saw was me, and I was like, I mean, really me? Is this lighting? Is there something wrong with this? Maybe this mirror is a defective mirror.
It's a little warbly.
Is it a warbly mirror?
Yeah.
Or do we just tell ourselves that?
Anytime I see a mirror that even just looks slightly warbly, I'm like, ugh, it's a warbly mirror, it's not me.
Anyways, I thought that this morning, and then, and I also just like, this isn't going anywhere. What I decided was maybe it wasn't the mirror, maybe it's just all these energy efficient light bulbs, and I just don't feel like I am uncomfortable going on public record and saying like, I just don't want to have them in my apartment. And is that okay? And like, should I, in advance of what will eventually be only those kind of light bulbs, should I buy a stockpile of other nice looking light bulbs, or do I just need to give up on light bulbs altogether and go back to like candles and lanterns, coal or oil or angel tears or whatever runs those, but I don't want to use the energy saving ones, so, because it just makes you look upsetting. Like, I think I have, we just turned 30, Tegan and I both just turned 30, and people are always like, you look so young, and then this morning I was like, not if you saw me in this mirror walking through, but I just want to get like a whole skin peel.
You need to slow down. You just had deli belly, all right?
I was gonna like. I actually thought to myself too, like my hair was really it was humid or something last night when I went to bed, and my hair looked repulsive when I woke up, and I just thought to myself I should get hair extensions, maybe something to balance everything. That's real, people. That's helped Marty. You ever feel that way, Ted? Like my hands are so swollen right now, and I just am like, why? Why are my hands?
Need some water?
Maybe I'm just you're thirsty. I am thirsty. You know, I think it's unfair that our bodies make us swell up when we have water. Like I think everything should be a swelling down when you don't give yourself something.
But I have to say that was the one good thing about deli belly. Is after 2 days, you just like. You look in the mirror and you're like,
no, it's not politically correct.
Jeez, it's not politically correct. I'm not saying you want to be like that forever, but when it's not like you get your period, you feel bloated and covered in acne, or you don't like, you know, like everything bad that happens to you. There's always like another bad thing. You just look bad, but not deli belly. After deli belly, you're like.
Time?
Yeah.
That's kind of sort of like what I imagine when I think of humans from the future coming back. Yeah. I mean, I can't even imagine an alien sitting, can you? If they just sort of, you know. I don't know why I picked pen and paper as basically. I don't want it to like take this person that told me this thing didn't even tell you directly. They were very convinced. No, I was like, you telephone, you heard it from somebody else.
Well, sort of.
Yeah. Right. Now, obviously why you can't even get all the details, because you didn't even come up with the idea. It's not an original theory, and you didn't hear it from the person who had the original idea.
I couldn't come up with music, and I'm good at it. I don't have to have it.
Not that I could.
Like strawberries or something. It's like they were here, and you find them.
You don't understand the concept is what I said.
Yeah, it's true.
They also said that sometimes aliens pick places where intelligence isn't as high, like intelligent levels aren't as high, because people, they'll just be like, oh my god, there's a spaceship. Whereas like, if I saw one, I would be like telling everyone, I would be like, I saw a spaceship and I'm not stopping until we figure out why that spaceship is here, and I will make it my life's work. So, whereas like, they'll just be like, you will not believe what I saw a spaceship. I bet you if you go down to one of those little towns that you're making fun of right now and you go to the people that thought that they found a spaceship, that's all they talk about.
You're
so, right, again, very debunked.
Yeah. Get off the phone.
Get off the phone. Don't sue the store or us. I mean, you're really doing this by your free will. We just suggested the idea. I didn't say do it. Maybe you want to try it. Well, we're going to play one more song, and then we're going to do like a signing, and you can get photos, and we'll tell you things. But I just wanted to tell you that in the back room, they have a monitoring system, and we watched a lot of you as you were coming in.
Camera
everywhere. And I just wanted to say that you all seem really nice. And I don't go to in-stores because of things like that, because I don't like to be looked at in the light. I mean, when you're looking at me, it's okay, because like I'm in control, even though it seems like you're controlling me, I'm really manipulating you. But I don't like to go to things where I'm out of control, like house parties where people I don't know are there, and like that kind of stuff. And you seem really nice, so thanks for coming. And most of you do this when you're walking, by the way. Like, you really were scared, and you really took a lot of, you risked a lot to come down those stairs, and we're not going to punk you or whatever they do, and or put sticks up your bums or your faces and whatever people do in rock bands over here. But we're going to try to be tougher at our show in London. Tegan has an outfit planned, and it's pretty intense. We're going to be like half of our show and then half like a London band. Like, Tegan's going to have fire cannons on her side of the stage, and I'm just not. I'm just going to have like a recliner. Sarah, just so everyone knows, Sarah spent the afternoon reading NME. I wanted to know about you. Culture shock right now. I wanted to know more about you. You are the people. Don't read NME. I'm just teasing. I'm only teasing. Anyways, no, seriously, are any of you coming to the London show?
Yeah.
Well, we'll see you there. We'll also see you at the table in about 3 minutes when we're done with the song. And but seriously, for those of you who want to make a dash out to go and catch, we'll do something else. Maybe we won't see you, but we'll see you at the show. And if we're not going to see you at the show or at the table, well, fuck you. Funny.
Oh yeah, and our record came out today.
Yay! Oh, it's shit. Fucking airbags, that's all we are. What did I say? Twin airbags.
Twin airbags.
Aww. We're a little better than flight boxes, though. Tegan said, made a really good point, though. Airbags save lives.
They do.
Buy a record, stay away. Fuck you. Again. I just want to point out that this is our thing, because we weren't going to bring it out, but...
You brought it up.
I know, I brought it up inadvertently, but, like, now I'm bringing it up because, you know what? What is this whole thing that we're all so afraid of? Like, enemy doesn't like us, so they can suck my cock anyway, I don't really care. But the reason why I'm saying that is only because they said on our last record, yeah, we don't like cock. That we were okay even though we hate cock. But I don't hate cock, I love cock. So we all love cock in the band. I mean, they let us show much cock in the band. Yeah. We love cock, so I just wanted to correct that.
They love their own cocks, and we just like cocks. They just don't have veins in them.
And second of all, I just want to say that I think it's so weird, because Enemy reviewed our record a couple months ago and gave us a 7 out of 10 and said they fucking loved it.
And they loved our cocks,
they, I guess. And then now they said that they don't like it. They changed their minds. And so I liked Enemy too, but now I changed my mind.
They didn't like the way that you sucked their cock.
I want you to stop talking about cocks, actually. It's kind of uncomfortable. And my point was that you're an airbag.
Yeah.
But I'm not. So Sarah wrote all the songs. So I just want Enemy to know that I'm like going to go home and I'm going to like desperately write them like a wicked ass record. And I'm going to come over here and I'm going to get all fucked up on drugs. And I'm going to lay around on the stage and I'm going to scream hysterically, and then they can put me on the cover. With me wearing a cock. That's how like a brilliant cover, actually. That actually would be really, really funny. I could wear like a tutu. Yeah. I have a bottle of like JD in my hand and like. Actually, I'm really upset that you said the tutu part. Because, like, why? Because then I imagine you in a tutu and me with a cock in actually. I think that might fly you. The people in our band don't even swear. Like, they literally don't even swear. Can you imagine what it's like to hang out with us all the time and you don't even swear? Like, that they say frick and bang.
Yeah.
And we're like, cock, 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 cock. Like, really scary. Okay. I'm ready now. I think I'm back in the dark place that we can. Tegan and Sarah coming right up, everybody. Thanks for letting us open you up on the show. For Tegan and Sarah, we love their band, and we heard they got a really good review in anime. So. I bet everybody from our label right now is just like on the phone and they're all like, oh Christ, Tegan and Sarah just ruined their career. They're never gonna sell records in the UK ever, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Now you're making it seem like you hate the people at our label. No, I love the people at our label. No, I don't. I didn't say that. Yeah. I just mean the blah 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 thing was like maybe. Blah blah blah, like I don't know, industry speak, you know?
Yeah.
Like, how our numbers of shipments been decreased because
they're like cock.
They're like cock. Will that ruin their chances of being lesbian twins come to the UK? Okay, we're gonna stop.
Yeah.
We're gonna stop this. It's like we're on meth or something. Okay, we don't do that. Obviously. That's why we don't sell records here. So, okay, no, just joking. I'm taking all that back. You know what? How do we fix this?
I think if we go like this and then just turn back around,
we're really glad you all came. First show in 2 months. We're a little hyperactive because we're stuck on planes. So many people are recording right now, so this would be on the internet. I just want to save my mom that we're really sorry about all the cock stuff.
And the vein.
That vein thing probably just disgusting. I was really sick. So. Anyway, this is all part of the show, so we'll see you in London in a few weeks. And we're Tegan and Sarah, and we'll see you at the table. And we're really sorry.
You may know, or you may not know, I guess. And I wrote it. It was the first song that I wrote when I was
so cocky.
This next song, you're gonna all know. It's gonna be really good. Frère Jacques.
No.
I mean, you may not know it. Like, I guess I just mean that.
If oh, we all know what you meant.
Yes, everybody, this is the one song that people like about Anne. I mean, it's millions.
You may know this song from such,
No, I don't know. Anyway,
you know where the song is in?
That movie with Jennifer Lopez, Monster in Law?
Yeah, it's true.
They played it during the credits, but not the first song in the credits, the second song.
Like, you have to be the DOP's mom, and then you're like, I can't wait to see his name. What is this song? I've heard it before. I love this. Anyways, but this is the thing. I lived in Vancouver for a number of years, and then I moved away. And this was the, I did not still live here. And so, those are all the people that screamed, people Tegan's dated this year, so. Know that Sarah actually doesn't like it here. Every time she comes here, all she does is drive around with me and my mom in the car and talk about how boring Vancouver is. So, just so you know, Sarah has solo records coming out later this year. When you're thinking about which one you'd like to purchase, I'm going to suggest that you buy mine. And I'm going to suggest that if you know our band, it's because I probably wrote a song. This one, or you can play like Superstar, like that's one that you like. I don't hear anyone ever been calling for the song. And I know it's popular, but I think people are annoyed by it. So.
We went to have our first sleepover with non-family friends, and like they were friends of our family, but they were not family. and the kids were our age, and before we had a really wonderful sleepover and everything was good. I mean, we had a wonderful day, and then that night when we went to have the sleepover, the girl child that we slept in her room, she was used to praying, I guess, before she went to bed, and she told me and Deegan, well, she said, actually, do you know who Jesus is? And we were like, no. And then she said, well, you better take him into your heart or you will burn in the river of hell forever. That's what she said. She was five. She was 5 years old. Anyways, that did not sound awesome. I didn't know really who Jesus was or what burning in river of hell would mean. But I was, well, we were totally traumatized. We didn't do very well with change. And so we were like, we didn't even really know what death was at this point. So we were like, whatever that sounds like, it was scary. And so, anyways, my mom was really ticked off and she didn't really want us to know about anything scary because she wanted us to be sweet and not cry or feel scared about death. But that pretty much started us on the path of being worriers. Like, we always worried that we were going to die, or that if we were apart from each other, that the other one would die. Or, like, I started to think that I had cancer in all different parts of my body. I know, it's so funny. Assholes. I'm like, yeah, I was 6 and I thought I was going to die. People are like, come on. I'm just kidding. No, it was cute. I mean, it was cute in that way where, like, now in retrospect, I probably seemed really sweet that I was like, I think I'm dying. And my mom was like, you're not dying. But inside, I would be like, yes, I am. Or, like, one time my mom took me to get an ultrasound to prove that I didn't have cancer. And then she took me to Muffins afterwards to get a muffin. And that's what it was called. And after I ate the muffin. The muffin, my mom was like, see, now you know because of the ultrasound that you don't have cancer. And I was like, mm-hmm. But inside I was like, yes, I do. And anyway, so that was all information that leads to the part where we started writing songs, and I would always write songs about things probably I thought up when I was on drugs, which don't do drugs, they're bad, but I did, and I used to write weird, like, just incoherent shit. And Tegan used to write about Jesus all the time. And I swear to God, this is good. There's a real payoff in this story. But one of our very first public gigs in high school was at an all ages club, and it was like no alcohol, and it actually was religious. It was a religious kind of like a drop in center type place. Like, it was called like Soul Center or something. No idea that it was religious when we got the gig. So we play this show, and we have all these songs that are like incoherent. Tegan has a bunch of songs about Jesus, good one. And then I had one that was about God. Are they the same person?
No. Oh my God.
Anyways, and at the end of the gig, the people there loved us because they thought we were a religious band. Because Tegan was singing about Jesus.
It was pretty alternative. The band that opened had like the lead singer had a shirt that says Satan sucks dick.
It's pretty progressive.
Yeah, it is pretty progressive.
Like, they were like really, you hit your face again. I mean, are you on drugs? Are you drinking? What's happening? Anyways, so this next song, the reason why I'm telling you all of this, totally, like, it seems right now that we're just talking to talk like we're on cocaine, but the point is, Tegan is about to play an unreleased song that kind of reminds me of when we were in high school, because it's really dark and it's like, you were goth. Like, Tegan did not have a normal light bulb in her room for like 3 years. She had one black light. You couldn't see anything. Like, I would go into Tegan's bedroom and I would be like, Tegan? Hello? And she would be hanging. My room was full of rainbows and gayness, and Tegan was like in the dark in the corner crying. So weird. Anyways, that is what this next song is about.
I feel like I have to come up with something original and something I haven't done before. So since all I know are power chords and then C and G, I'm like, okay, how am I gonna tune my guitar or put the capo somewhere that people in the audience are gonna be like, that one again? Oh God. So it's like you start with at a disadvantage. You start at negative when you start, because you're like, okay, trying not to sing about my relationship, trying not to sing about love, don't say love, don't say heart, don't say run, don't say hide. Like, Sarah has all these rules for me. And so it's like, I can't use any of the chords I know, I can't use any of the experience I've had, and I can't use any of the words that I can spell. Or rhyme. And then it's like, I gotta do it so that my neighbors can't hear me, so I kinda have to start off whispering, you know? And then there's like hours of just strumming along, and then you basically just hum, kind of like you're like, oh,
I usually eat lunch, and then I go back and I listen to all the voice notes on my phone, and I'm like,
oh.
But which part of that is what?
Just wait.
I'll tell you. So then, like, a couple more hours of what I just did that I won't do again for you happens. And then all of a sudden, a melody line or some sort of, like, rhythm, whatever, like, a thing happens. And then all of a sudden, the excitement builds. And then it's, like, 2 hours of blurry stuff that I can't remember. And that's probably when, like, the Holy Spirit comes down and gives me the song. Really, really. Okay. So then the song happens. And then you get into, like, the finite, like, you know, like, or the, sorry, the, not the finite, the, you get into the details, basically, then you start fixing the lyrics and fixing the melody and, like, you know, recording different ideas and whatever. Okay, so, like, now 12 hours has happened. Then you go out for dinner, you watch Damages, you go to bed, you get up, and then you listen back to what you did. It's at that point that if the song is meant to be, it's going to be meant to be, because you're going to hear it and it's going to inspire you to finish it. Okay. Then I send it to Sarah. And then Sarah makes comments, and then I'll go out for dinner again. So now 2 days have passed. And then I have dinner, and then maybe I have like 2 or 3 mojitos. And then I come home, and I listen to the song. And that is when I get suckered into doing it all over again, because I'm like, this is awesome! Okay, yes, right here. Sarah doesn't think you're funny at all. Didn't even smile once.
I must be drunk because I'm not actually, I'm sober, but I feel like I'm drunk from heat because I generally feel quite self-conscious, not with sort of like my leather jacket / blankie, so it's weird. She looks good, right? It's fine, she looks good.
Special affection for unitards because I was the sound engineer on a high school play. My drama teacher was,
how many times are we going to have to hear about this?
In high school, my drama teacher, it's a really interesting idea. We went to a very interesting high school, and our drama teacher, he choreographed and wrote a play about Romeo and Juliet, all set to Elvis Costello's record, The Juliet Letters.
Okay.
And but it was like cool. It was really cool. But everyone in the performance wore unitards. I was the sound person, and I just had to like watch my peers dance around in this very like intense version of Romeo and Juliet, but all set to Elvis Costello's The Juliet Letters. I don't know, it was weird. And but I loved it. But like, it was pretty intense, like watching everybody dance around in unitards, like day after day after day after day. Because it's like unitard, you see like everything, and we're not like athletes. Like that's what I think unitards are meant for, is like people with bodies. It's like one step away from naked, and so like, I don't think it's meant for like everybody, you know? But like, you know, they just like stuck it out, and I really appreciated it. My drama teacher, I mean, it was amazing. They took it to the university drama, like it's like at the university they would have like the high school drama festival, and like it was like competitive and stuff. And
I never thought it was good. I saw it like 800 times, and I never thought it was good. And then I saw it at the big university.
It was amazing.
And it was like amazing. And except we were, I think it was only us that like other schools were all like. Oh.
Yeah, like, oh, drama teacher made you guys wear unity.
Yeah,
I was not a unity. Whatever, man. Like, you just, you know, have to, like, strip away all the, I don't know. It was, you know, but, anyways, I don't know why I brought that up, but, we will also be in unitards doing a, doing an improvised dance to, Elvis Costello's The Juliet Letters this evening, at an undisclosed location.
Weekend for the first time, Sarah came backstage
and
said,
spiral, big time.
Yeah, she was like, I'm taking a year off to take voice lessons and get braces. So, I mean, we're human and we definitely get self-conscious, and there's lots of moments. I mean, the whole first movie, I'm singing like half a step down from Sarah. Like, I'm like, why am I out of tune the entire time? Like, why doesn't anyone that works for us, our sound guy, our front house, our tour manager, some of our dearest friends, our guitar player, my manager, anyone, just as a, like a word to the wise, the next record. If there is a song that I consistently sing out of tune, just tell me. Don't tell me in front of a group of people. Just take me aside and be like, look, old Yeller, we really, you're trying really hard, that's not your key. You know, and as we get older and our voices change, I have to take baby and I have to do a couple steps down from it. And that's not a big deal. It doesn't mean my career's over. It just means maybe 19 needs to be sung in a different key. And Emmy's here tonight, and she told us that when we put the record out. She was like, Tegan, you need to, that's not, you're not singing to. So, and I rejected that and resisted it. Now it's on DVD forever, so, but there's definitely lots of moments like that on the DVD, so.
We try not to beat up on
our
ourselves.
Bathing suit that I'm wearing and the States thing, I'm like, why would you just put a bathing suit on? Why would you
that's
come fit in your clothes?
That, you know what?
So weird.
You need to just be proud of that. That is a Northeast Calgary-ish bathing suit. You need to just, it's sort of a 2011 version, but just like respect, you look good. Don't worry about it. You got big guns, you're fine. Don't worry about it. We are not Lady Gaga, like we are not in the kind of band where we want, or Madonna, or like a lot of the bands and artists that we grew up listening to were all about this mystery and like David Bowie, like so many fantastic, amazing artists. What? She's like, who are you? Like,
No, I said, you're like, we're not Madonna or Lady Gaga or David Bowie. Like, you could have picked bands a little closer to what we're like.
No, I'm just, let me get to the end of my point. You wonder why I have self-esteem problems. Like, you wonder why I'm like that nervous dog on the season roll on Dog Whisperer. It's like, I'm so nervous because she's always judging me. Okay. Anyways, we're not this polished, you know, we are not a where are you going? You hate us. You wish it would be. I know that person. Too much noise. Okay, so I think that, you know, I use those bigger bands as an example of like that was never the aspiration to be sort of a glossy or a larger than life amplified persona. Like we, if anything, we knew that one of the things that we could exploit was how normal, very normal we are, and I think that we learned really early on that that was going to be the thing that actually connected us to an audience. We weren't necessarily sure who that audience was, but we knew that if we were vulnerable and we were ourselves and we were sort of, you know, normal, then people would think like, holy shit, that could be.
But there is a curfew, so we have to button lift and play the song. So I'm not gonna introduce this song or tell you a long-winded story except to say that that whole thing about not wanting to be in a relationship forever is totally true. So spread that word. I want to be in as many relationships and marriages as possible before I die. What do you think?
I am not like that.
I'm not like that either. In fact, someone recently called me a frigid robot. You want to clap so bad.
I can't do it.
It's like screws her up. It's weird. That's why Johnny's not playing. It's like, I know you desperately want to clap. Maybe just pat your leg like this. She has no rhythm. None. No rhythm whatsoever. It's awkward and weird. It makes me start dripping sweat. Like dripping. As soon as I hear a little bit of clapping, it's just like sweat. Drip. Pat your leg. Sorry, it just freaks me out. Last night, it was like skiing a black diamond ski hill. I just was like, oh no, it's like so terrifying. You shithead, don't do that. Somebody's screaming, shut the fuck up, Sarah, which is what the girl yelled before she attacked me in LA.
ears and eyes of the audience. If you're upset and you feel like somebody is, if somebody just gives you the wrong feeling, well, maybe not that, because sometimes I'm weird people. That's true. Okay, I'll do that. Because everyone should be able to be how they are. But if you think you're in a confession, you can be. Audience, whatever. Really, really excited looking. I mean, all are smiling. There's a few people not smiling, but there's a lot of very attractive people too. It's unique. People love it when you tell them that they're attractive in New York, because they're not usually, you have to be so competitive to be attractive in New York. Like, there's no like, roll a little bit and like down, oh, I'm attractive? Really? You find me attractive? It's really like, I always tell people when they don't know New York very well, I always tell them that New York is the kind of place where people get their plaid shirts dry cleaned. That's how fancy New York is. You're like, I don't have to pick up my dry cleaning. I'm like imagining like, you know, like I went to a wedding recently and like, the tuxedo that somebody just got or whatever. Wrong. I seriously didn't mean to say that word. That was wow. That was I think that's an old-fashioned word. Most of you don't know that word. Sort of from the early 80s.
It was saved by the shock on a lot of people's faces that everyone knew what it
was. It was a Color Me Bad song. You don't know what it is. Johnny specifically laughs at my sexual jokes because he's so sweet. I like it when you think I'm funny because I know I haven't crossed the line. Like if I have crossed the line, or you crossed the line, he's not smiling. No, look how much he's laughing. He's like, turned 8 shades of red. This is a city with, have you ever watched
Public Access? I think
you've done really good. You've talked about jizz. You accuse New Yorkers of being borderline pretentious. And you singled out an incredibly sweet girl in front row and
Lily,
her to watch it. I say it's great. You play another song now. I say
that. Oh, that's good. Did you look at the, did you say I thought it was pretentious?
New York.
Oh, no. I just was telling people backstage, I got so into ironing recently that I ironed my pants, I ironed shirts. I love, it's not pretentious, it's spiffy, it's well done.
Yesterday Sarah had hives, today I have an eye infection, so that's why I'm wearing sunglasses, I swear to you. Okay, but just quickly, he's gross there. Yeah, and it kind of fills up with green goop every couple of minutes, so to avoid you having to see that and losing the vibe here, I'm gonna wear sunglasses, so just pretend I'm a really cool rock star.
Okay. I'm on medication, so I feel high. And
she's acting really, really weird and inconsistent, so.
My mom called me and woke me up this morning to make sure I was still alive, and I was really angry because you didn't check on me last night. I could have died on that medication.
I had my own issues. I thought I was going blind.
You can't die from an eye infection.
But I could lose the most important thing I have. Psych. We'll talk about that later. We're gonna do a couple songs for you.
You know what's really funny about getting sick, and not like just like a cold or a flu, is like my mom told my grandma, and she told like people that I know, and so over the last couple days, people are calling me to tell me other times I've been sick. It's like this weird phenomenon. Have you ever had that happen where you get sick and then people call you to tell you about other times you've been sick? Like,
no.
That's what, you don't know what I'm talking about? Like, people called me this morning and were like, do you remember that time that you got hives 2 summers ago? No, you did. You thought they were spider bites. But they weren't, they were hives, so. Yeah, wicked. And that was happening this morning, so. I just thought I'd share that with you. I appreciate it. I worry about you. Yesterday on stage at the show, which thank you to everybody who came out to that show. Did so many people, you guys were at that show? Okay, good. Yeah, sometimes you make it up that I don't care about you.
Mm-hmm. And I know it's for the sake of the audience, getting a good laugh out of me and stuff. And I do care about you. This happened yesterday. I sent Tegan a letter. I sent her a letter telling her really nice things about her. Like over a month ago. And yesterday on the phone, I heard her tell somebody, like, oh, Sarah sent me this letter. She's so sweet. I read it to my mom, and I read it to my dad. And I was like, you got my letter? I thought it was lost in the mail, because she never mentioned it, ever. Like, I make it up that she doesn't care about me.
Well, it was a really weird letter. Like,
Sarah said things to me that nobody has ever said to me. Like, she was just like, okay, well, you don't have to get into it. We haven't even talked about it yet. Well, it's just really nice. Sarah's not typically very nice to me. Like, not in, like, a mean way or anything. Like, just in a sister way. Like, she's a sister to me. And she sent this really, really nice letter.
You're special.
It's so weird to talk to you when you have your sunglasses on. It's just funny. I can think you're Bono or something.
No, it's worse if I don't. It's just hard.
Try singing one without it. It'll be fun.
Okay, but if you see the green goop, don't go on the internet and talk about it, okay?
Let's just leave this between us. Okay? Tell everyone you saw us on the Instagram.
This is a sweet sentimental song. You don't want to wear sunglasses in a sweet sentimental song.
You know what? Your hives blend into your skin, okay?
See, this is how much I care.
Just close it. Just keep it closed.
It closes on its own.
I have to be able to look, and it's like you're a little baby mouse. Oh, just hit your head.
No, I can't see.
Oh, your eye. Oh, no. Sunglasses.
I'm going to blame that on you.
Oh, sorry. The last time we did a West Coast tour was in January, and we finished up in San Diego, and I was getting ready to move across the country. You all right? Do you need ice? And so after the San Diego show, we had nowhere to sleep, so we booked it that way because we had a really early flight home from LA the next day. So we drove all night in the van, and then we slept in the van in a Burger King parking lot.
Taco Bell.
Same diff. And
no, Taco Bell's way better than Burger King.
Yeah, okay. And then we slept like on the... That night was really funny because we were like begging each other to sleep on the benches. And I ended up giving up and sleeping on the floor of the van because I just needed to stretch out. Like, my muscles were, like, freaking out. And so, anyways, it was a really long night. And then we took a flight home that day from L.A. to Vancouver. And when I got home, I opened my bags and my computer and a bunch of my, like my headphones and my Discman and a watch and a clock and, like, all this stuff had been stolen out of my bag. And I felt very sad because the day before that, my wallet had gotten stolen. With a blank check in it and like all of my credit cards and my ID and whatever, and I was like about to move across the country and so I didn't have anything, and I was very, very sad. And so I think
I needed the wallet.
I think from the stress of it, I forgot about the tour or whatever. Like, I can't really remember a lot from that tour, but anyways, I was thinking about this last night. My aunt in Atlanta, she came to visit we all visited my grandma a couple weeks ago, and I was recounting this horrible situation and what had happened to me, and then they all started in on how I should, like, there's, like, some sort of way I can, like, check and make sure that people aren't, like, getting passports with my ID, and I'm like, but I canceled everything, and then they're like, oh, in, like, 15 years it could come back to haunt you, and, like, and it made me feel so scared. Anyway. There's no conclusion to that story. I just thought I might share it with you. I saw this lady last night, while we were getting to the van on the way to the show, walk into a pole, like, full on. Wow. And she stood there for a couple... I watched her. I was on the phone. I wanted to get in the van, but I was like, I gotta watch her. What if she falls down? Like, has she been talking to Rob, our drummer? Where are you, Rob? Did you leave? Where is he? He left. Looking in our van, won't stay and support us. Where are they? No, they left. Okay. They must be eating next door. Rob was talking to the lady. He discombobulated her. And then she was like, don't hit my van, or whatever, with the car door. And then he got in the van, and she turned around, like full speed, turned around and went to walk into her room and walked right into a pole. And I, the poor thing, she stood there and held her face.
Do you remember that time that we played in Ontario, and then it was winter, and those girls, they were like fans of ours, they were like waving crazily at us. They're like, hi!
And then one of them fell, and it was like a chain reaction on the ice, and they all fell, and then they were like, and then they ran, crouched down, trying to see, maybe we would see them, maybe we had noticed them or whatever. It was cute. I fell. I moved to Montreal this year, and it's cold there, and I fell. Thank you very much. I'm going to play one more song. And which one will it be? We'll do You Went Away. You want to do You Went Away? All right. Sure. Okay. Let's see now. I had so many stories last time. How come we even... I had stories 5 minutes ago when you stopped me talking. And now I just want to let you not talk. I want to make you make it uncomfortable because you can... Uncomfortable? I have to wear sunglasses where a CD store my eye is bleeding green goop. Like, uncomfortable. I'm uncomfortable. Satisfied. Give me a story. One time, we did this tour in Canada, and we decided that it would be really effective if we did, like, in-stores all the way across Canada. We really wanted to impress our record company.
Yeah, I'm telling you.
Side note. Okay. And so, anyway, so we would do one in each city, and a lot of them really were crappy. And, like, we have an audience in Canada. Like, it wasn't our fault. It was something went wrong. We're not really sure what. But
I think we're talking like two or three people.
Yeah, like two or three people. And one of them, I know we've probably told this story before, but one of them was in a mall and there was no room in the store, so they wanted to move us out into the mall. And so we get there and we were like, no. Bad idea. There's nobody here anyway. Let's just, but we just do it in the back storage room or something. Like, please don't make us do it in the mall, please. And so it's just a bit Tiffany. Like, it's just a bit, like, too 1985, like, for us. And so, anyway, we ended up having to do it. But before we went on, they played our record, like, in the mall, very loud. And
and in between, like, tracks would be like, you're listening to Tegan and Sarah. They're going to be in the upper, you know, blah, 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 on the third stairwell in 25 minutes, like, over and over again.
And so finally they, like, drag us out there, and we, like, go stand by. They had, like, a little PA set up. It was ridiculous. It was outrageous. It was horrible. And so then as we came out, they restarted the CD, and they played, it was our old record, and so they played the first, and it was so loud, and an old man ran by screaming, think of other people! And he was, like, screaming, and then we had to, like, start playing, and it was so
embarrassing. Do you remember we shared a mic?
Did we?
Yeah, I don't remember that. And we didn't have our guitars plugged in or anything because it just kept feeding back, so we unplugged the guitar, so we had, like, one mic between the two of us, and we just picked songs and passed the mic back and forth, and there was, like, three fans, and even they looked horrified.
Someone threw a quarter at us, remember?
Someone put the quarter at us, and, like, I guess if we chosen to be there, like, to busk in the middle of the mall.
Yeah, this is on purpose. This looks really fun for us, too.
I don't know why, but... I feel so out of breath. Are you out of breath? No? Oh, you look out of breath. I was really giving her during that one. I also had to... It's terrible timing. This feels like something you'd say at the end of a show, but... I must be giving her a period. But anyway, I was having this moment during the last song. Once in her entire... Oh, sorry. Sarah said to talk about it. This has only happened, like, one other time, and I feel really emotional. I feel like I could cry, and I... I feel like I have to get myself together, because we've been putting out this mailbox, and everybody's been writing us letters, and it just... Oh, my God. Are you getting your period? I must be, but... It's true. I'll say it. Do you want me to say it? Tegan's very upset because we have been putting out this mailbox and we've been collecting letters in every city, and it's sort of overwhelming because obviously throughout our career people have told us stories about how they found our music or why they like our music or why they hate our music but they still come to our shows or whatever. People tell us all sorts of things, but it's been so significant on this album to hear the stories that you guys tell us and the letters that you're leaving at the mailbox. We just sit backstage and read them. That's all we do. It's crazy. It's sort of hard to put in words right now because I think that what we're starting to realize is that we thought you guys were sort of what kept us going, but maybe there is a bit of this kind of like realization that I know we've been important to you. And it's sort of, it's weird because I think people will say like, oh my God, I loved you in high school or whatever, but I don't think that we had really taken into consideration like how important like being out and being gay and all of those kinds of things really were. So anyways, we've been sitting And even if we were significant to you, not because we were gay or whatever, but we've been sitting
maybe
back
just
stage.
Our haircuts.
It could have just been our hair. I mean, it doesn't matter. The point is that it has been very emotional for us. We've been reading these letters, and it's just, we just thank you so much for the stuff that you guys give us. It really is so important to us. We really appreciate it.
This is really cheesy, and I'm getting my period, but I have this moment where during that last song, I saw some of my friends that I went to high school with, who are here right now, and we're still, you know, best friends, and I love them so much, and they've seen us play so many really, 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 really bad shows, and I was thinking about how when you're doing anything, like, not just as a musician, but sometimes when it gets really hard, you think, like, what gets you through, like, almost like the way an athlete thinks, like, you're like, I'm gonna beat other people, like, that's how you keep going, is you become competitive, like, you think, I'm gonna show people, I'm gonna make something amazing, I'm gonna play an amazing show, or I'm gonna write an amazing song, I'm gonna show people, and I had this moment when, I can't even believe I'm getting emotional, I'm gonna die.
Suite in it, and Tegan and I rented the basement suite from my mom, and
yeah.
I was
6 months of like, Sarah didn't have a job, but I did.
I had a job.
You didn't have a job.
Well,
how do you say job?
Job.
Yeah, yeah. Job.
I did have a job. You did not have a job. Your job was waking me up early every morning, and
so you could go to work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And clean the house because
and clean the house,
like
but
sin.
She would call me up an hour. And, yeah, this is her thing. It smelled like sin, and she would like say like that the dirt and the dust building up was sin, and like you know things in the. Anyway, it was so annoying. I hated her. So
we decided we would never live together.
No.
Again.
But you do love each other enough to be able to collaborate on the working.
Love's a big overstatement.
Yeah.
I see.
We have a mutual respect for one another.
Yes. Well, you're equally talented, but would you say in different directions? That's very generous.
Yeah.
What a generous little woman you are.
Sarah's the artistic one. I'm the business.
We have a good partnership with what we do, like in music, like beyond just the music side of things. Like I think we have a good partnership, or we're working on our partnership for sure. So
yeah, well, yeah. I think it's worth it. I mean,
I went to therapy like a year ago. Sarah's just starting to discover her inner self, so she's like very eloquent right now.
Your inner self.
Yeah.
I'm looking for my inner
self. That's a therapy term.
Yeah. I know. I
inner
know.
Self.
I know. That's why I looked down my sleeve.
I'm feeling like my inner self wants to come out. So yeah.
Uh-oh.
But anyway.
Duck.
Yeah, no.
Sister.
No, it's good. It's
okay,
good.
Here's the thing.
Okay.
You used to be called Sarah and Tegan. Now
yeah.
It's Tegan and Sarah. And Pigtails, so cute on this little
album.
We were
four.
You were adorable.
We were four when we put out that record. We were prolific even at a young age.
We had Britney beat. We wanted to be out there before she did, but she got to the Mickey Mouse Club, and all we got was that album.
Yeah.
So.
She's a pain, eh?
Yeah.
But these are such cute pictures. It's almost like you do love each other. We'll just pass on that.
Well, I think you can't, there's no doubt, like, there's no doubt in my mind that if Sarah wasn't in my life, I would be, like, I know this is going to sound really corny, but I'd be very empty without her,
yes.
I think. I mean, when you think of what a twin is, I know, when you think of what a twin is, I mean, it's really like,
just say, thank you, dear.
Yeah.
Thank you.
We were supposed to be a green and a yellow cup, and we came out two green cups.
Yeah.
I mean, come on, like,
oh,
that's
for
pretty
God's
cool.
Sake.
I tell you, you can't win with you guys, eh?